during the quest to discover these ancient arts and all this amazing architecture from the past, I ended up stumbling across this cathedral, St. Rumboldt in Mechelen, in the Flanders region, and of like the Brussels, Belgium area. And it is an unbelievable place, and I do not understand this one bit. And I am very curious to find more about it. So this appears to be a drawing from back in an 1800s book that shows the tower as if it were completed and a lot longer than we see it is today. And this thing seems to go on forever. And each one of these details is perfect and pristine and immaculate. And it looks like it all has a purpose. It looks like it's like some kind of rocket ship or like a Saturn V times a billion, with amazing ornamentation everywhere, different symbols all over the place, perfect symmetry, unbelievable construction, and it just absolutely had to have a purpose. It looks like almost like a giant organ or something ridiculous. And then at the top, there's this incredible ether gathering magic device of some sort, pinnacle mastery, and they put a cross on top. And the Mechelen, this shows how high it like apparently was in the past. And so I'm not sure if it was this high or higher or whatever, because the way it is now, it is only about half of that in height. And it is absolutely the most impressive thing I've ever seen. And it almost looks like it's from a different world. Like you'd see this in some Prometheus style movie or something somewhere. And this image was one of my first things. And the first time I saw it, I posted it on Reddit. And people were like, oh, that's things, what are you talking about? There's nothing there, there's blah, blah, blah. Because I was looking at how the primitive house on the right, and then it gets a little, it's almost like it's tept through time. And the one that's taken and built when this photo was taken is the house on the right, the least impressive house of all. And then you go back in time and the things get more and more immaculate. And so I've been getting to kind of see this groupthink on Reddit, and it hit when someone posted this the other day, and almost all of the comments were talking about how this was just some really nice paper mache work. And it really hit me that there is some amazing cognitive dissonance happening there. Like that these people will believe that this is paper mache, and even though there's no signs of its construction, no photos of them building it, and they just can't grasp that it could be something else than what they're told. Either they're trolls, or groupthink is just at a ridiculous level. Back to Mechelen, though. This tower and this area seem absolutely incredible. These buildings all seem like they had an amazing purpose, all seem like they extended far beyond what they are at today. You can even go to the top of that observatory. I'd love to do it. The view is incredible. You can see all kinds of amazing buildings in different places. But this thing just seems incredibly out of place. And look at all the things on the side. Why would you add stuff to this building if it didn't have a purpose? Why would you decorate it so well, prepare it so perfectly, carve so immaculately, spend so much money, time, effort? It almost looks like there's another piece that went on top, like it was like a Lego, like someone was just building these construction things with these pinnacles and massive structures from another dimension. These buildings are nuts, and these could have been everywhere. You know, we've seen Notre Dame take a big hit in the last couple of years, and you know, that thing crumbles, and you can easily just never know. The future never really knows for sure and what was there. And this has a clock on it, a giant clock right in the middle of it. And whether that's just to see time, you know, that wasn't in the older drawings that showed the tower being taller. So like, how many times was it repurposed? How many times was this thing reclaimed by other people just coming by? And who was the originator of this? Will we ever know? Because the books don't tell a thing. And then looking inside these massive places has me wondering whether there was some kind of machine, fountain, some kind of incredible resonating device that inevitably got taken, because look at how small the people are. And those are the people that supposedly built this. They look like tiny ants. And you know, was this made for giants? Was it made by giants? Was it something totally different? Was it just a giant harmonizing music making thing? And I'm beginning to think, and these fountains as well, running water is so important, I feel, to opening up the mind. There's something absolutely there with fountains and opening this creative spirit and the just some power that's trapped within us. I know that for a fact. Shower thoughts, all different kinds of thoughts by water are always the best. I'm willing to believe they tapped into that and the power and the memory and the magic and wonder of water and the healing properties and everything that it can do. It can do so much more than we think, I guarantee that. And these may have been fusion devices, who knows? But also, I've been thinking a lot lately about the music and their importance for music and need for music. And it makes me think back to the times when I used to always kind of, when I'd live in the city or just be, or walk around really, sometimes even in nature, like around the fields I used to live in, I would turn my music on very softly, just so it sounded like I was hearing music, like the music that I was listening to from a distance. And it always just gave an amazing feeling, almost like a subconscious, innate, ancient instinct would almost erupt because it would feel so good. And there have been a couple times in my life when I've camped out at places, at music events and festivals, and there's been that same feeling. You wake up with music, the whole community wakes up with music. Everybody kind of gets on the same wavelength right away. People are kind of really, you know, joining a new kind of union through sound. And they can really, you can do a wondrous things to a community by having everybody unite with the same frequencies and utilize that power for whether it's war or happiness or mourning, sadness, work, getting ready to do anything, getting pumped up, getting energy, healing, so much. And I bet they definitely use that because music seems like a very important thing. Above all, the power of music, the power of obtaining the Holy Spirit and potentially producing energy seem to be my top potential reasons for why they would go through all this trouble to build these amazing things. You know, why wouldn't you just build something? If you needed a view or you needed a clock somewhere, why not just build something really simple and straight up and then a clock? These things are huge. Look at these buildings. Like, that tower has a definite purpose. It is a machine. It looks so much like different types of miniaturized kind of circuit board activities, and you know, this is on a grand scale, and with the symmetry, I have a feeling that the ether, the spiral nature of the ether, interacted with these in such an interesting way, and something happened because this is so much care. Every single bit of this, it had to have been created with a machine. To carve this all by hand would take so much time, and to prepare all this and plan it and quarry it and just to gather it, construct it. I don't understand how they could have done it. Kudos to whoever and whatever generation did it. But all over this Flanders, Belgium, Brussels area, there are some unbelievable buildings like this. And it makes you wonder how many more there were in the time. And you know, maybe these were just the relics left over from when our era people came, and these things were just popping out of cliffs all over the place. Like, different erosions would happen and maybe unveil different ones. Now, this whole process could have been going on for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, and it all, like, you know, who was, it all dates back to how and who we are and who we come from and what this planet and world we're on is. And I think flat Earth and the whole revitalization of that concept is what is allowing for us all to really envision the true nature of all of these buildings that are now coming about in old pictures, and we're discovering we're all over America and are just all over uniformly around the world in these star forts and all these things. And I think it's all pieced together because, I mean, I grew up believing in the distant galaxies and, you know, that we're just alone in this tiny ball, and oh no, is there anyone else out there that will ever hear our radio waves and stuff? You know, I got really deep into that growing up, and I always kind of suspected differently, and those different theories kind of just kept snowballing into a lot more thoughts and a lot more digging into ancient cultures and their thoughts. And you know, now this realization is so much better. It's, instead of are we alone, it's wow, how big is this? Who's watching us? Who made this? What is going on here? Where are these ancient civilizations from? Like, do we not, we don't have to go millions of light years away into some imaginary math world. We can go right above or below. We're so close to it. They wanted us to believe something that we're millions of light years away from the closest star. The next sun is that far away. Planets are uninhabitable all over the place, so far away, impossible. We'll never even come close to getting there if they were to exist even. And instead of the fact that just right beyond our barriers, there might be some magic waiting to be discovered, some stuff that puts aliens to absolute shame. Instead of a little tiny gray thing, there could be something that looks just like you and me, that can do so much more with their mind, their body, their spirit, their everything, their elements, their senses. They are just finely tuned versions of us that are living up to their full potential, and maybe we're not allowed to see them, you know, and maybe they are our giants, maybe there's just the Hindus, the different colors of people, all different kinds of gods floating, angels with wings, different kinds of so many different things all right next to us. It's so much better than the thoughts of them being millions of light years away in some hypothetical world where Elon Musk is the only one who can take us there. Garbage. This stuff is so much better. This path is much more beautiful. And we can explore this new kind of reality that's been hidden from us in all different directions. We can go to the North Pole, we can go to the South Polar regions and keep going, and we can go down underground in these mountains. Like, who knows if the mountains of Tibet are just littered with different pyramids and different temples and different things, and the Grand Canyon might have tons of them. There are certain areas that are off limits. There could be castles all over this place. And then just the way the Sahara was buried, like maybe in our somewhat recent time, maybe that's what happened all over the place. And then, you know, buildings came back up and people built on top and trees grew, and then it happened again, and then just more and more land. And, you know, instead of it being sand, it was dirt that had seeds and things in it, and plants grew from it. And, you know, there could be just so many things underneath us, so many civilizations buried, things that have never even been touched in a book, or names of civilizations that have never even been uttered in the English language or any language, because no one in our time has even just remembered them anymore. They could be lost forever, or someone could be containing the knowledge somewhere. And maybe north or south or below or even above, we will find it, but we gotta keep looking. Sadly, there are probably so many churches and towers and places just like this that are just in ruins underground, and people just, they just mix with stone. Nobody knows the difference. But either way, Mechelen is this area over here, this part of the world. And there are many different theories or places. Some say it's dated back to 1452 when it was started and took about 1583 to be unfinished. It's Gothic architecture. I've seen some stories that date to 12th century. Well, apparently the church is dedicated to Saint Rumboldt, who was one of the earliest missionaries in the Low Countries. He was martyred here in this area June 24th in the year 775. He succeeded Bishop Walroff in the see by the injunction of an angel who, according to the legend, again appeared and commanded him to resign the dignity. He gave sight to the blind, relieved men of evil spirits which were in possession of their bodies, restored a young nobleman to life, and did other miraculous acts. Having reproved a man who was living in adultery, he was killed by the latter with a hoe. Hence that instrument is emblematic of the saint. So this is pretty nuts. And after his death, he succored Mechelen when besieged and restored sight and life to persons who were continued or connected with the city. So he was definitely a saint in this area, and, you know, they inevitably made this thing dedicated to him, and they slapped a little tiny mouse hole down there for the humans to go into. So this place is a total mystery. I didn't want to bombard you all with a bunch of facts and different things from all the books, so I figured I'd leave it here in the background on these next sections. So feel free to tune me out whatever my talkings are and just go through each one of these pages. Some may be out of order, but they all shed a little bit of light on some of these buildings, the Hotel De Ville, the Rumboldt Cathedral, and a few of the other buildings that I kind of focused on in those pictures. And some of the things you can find out are just a little bit of extra information, like this one that says the materials for the spire of Mechelen Cathedral were already on the ground when, in 1583, the work was stopped by order of the Prince of Orange, who transported the stones to Holland and used them in building the town of Willemstad. So again, each one of these books that just has survived goes into their thoughts and their different out-of-context facts about what happened to this in the history. And, you know, they tell a huge amount of history, 100 years of history, with a couple sentences and expect everyone to be satisfied. And this goes a little bit deeper, but you can also see some are a little different. You know, the different purposes of these buildings, the different materials they were made out of. And it's just remarkable. The Hotel De Ville, that place is huge. And just, you know, what are the real purposes of these? How many of them were there around the place? And will we ever know? I really hope we do. These artists deserve recognition. They are masters, and I hope we, our human selves, are capable of all this. We just maybe need to focus a little harder. Regardless of all the mysteries of the history of all this architecture, there's one thing we know, and that's that art and the creative process, art, music, everything, played such an important role in these beings of the past. Like, just the fact that they were building buildings like this, those had to have taken time. Creativity was a masterful art with them. The fountains, they definitely probably utilized and connected water and the flowing of water to creativity, and they probably used a much purified water in a better way. Our earth was probably harmonizing. You can see the buildings all over the place. They'd always put them in beautiful spots. And, you know, they were in one with the noosphere, or the collective subconscious imagination. And our imaginations today and a lot of the things we have may be based on this etherical just collection of the world's creations throughout time that just exists all over the place in this ether, within those spirals, in the water, able for us to be tapped into it. And art and creativity, music, and all these beautiful things, building, crafting, everything, are the mechanisms for tapping into this amazing source of creativity, which is definitely what inspired, regardless of how and why, it inspired the creation of these towers and these buildings. Creativity is everywhere. It is the most divine force we have. I recommend everybody use it in their own perfect way. Here in the center of the universe, Mandala is the creator, drawing reality. Just wanted to also share some thoughts on this being a power, an electrical conductor, and just showing that maybe it was similar to Tesla's Wardenclyffe Tower, which I'll show in 1 second, but maybe, you know, these towers were ways that people could just use a certain technology and lights would work within a certain vicinity, radio signals, all kinds of things, electricity would just work when you were near, in the presence, or in the just vicinity, within miles of one of these towers, and then that would really give them a purpose, and maybe a combination of music, electricity, power, holiness, the sacred, all this stuff were all combined. And, you know, maybe this Tesla's Wardenclyffe, which was, you know, electricity to all without wires, was just our versions of trying to him reminiscing and rediscovering that ancient technology and putting it to good use. And this was the way he was able to do it with his minimal amount of money compared to what they probably had back in the day with all their riches and gold and all this stuff just at their disposal in their whatever type of advanced beings they were. But this is a great video I want to share from a guy named Flatwater Films, who did this destruction of this church that I think is somewhat local to him. And this just shows that, you know, within 5 days these things can be destroyed. And there are all throughout time, there's different methods of destruction. So that's not something that definitely is new to this time period. They must have been doing this all over the place. So this is a very sad thing. It almost feels like you're watching an animal or an innocent life being taken. But it's a structure, and it's a piece of history, and it happens all over the place. So we got to remember and honor these places and these artists who built them. Bless you all.